thanks the organizer for having me here. So I'm talking about the down of genetic disposition in family breast cancer. As the professor said, cancer is a genetic disease. But when you talk about genetics, we have to distinguish these two. One is as sporadical, one's familial. Sporadical is just by unlucky. It's random events. But when we talk about the familial, it's real genetics based on Mendelian genetics. And you see they have different frequency. Most of the breast cancer, in fact, 90% are sporadical breast cancer, only 10% or so are familial breast cancer. So that's the focus when we talk about familial breast cancer. Familial breast cancer is not a new concept. You go back as early as 1866, Dr. Broca already reported in her wife's family, 10 out of how many women were affected by breast cancer. So this is the first scientific report about the family breast cancer. And later on, people realized that in this particular type of breast cancer, in fact, among all the environment factors, lifestyle, nutrition, infection, genetic, so on and so on, genetics, this predisposition is the major factor. So family breast cancer is a genetic disease. Every people knows in the past 20 years or so, when BRCA1, BRCA2 were determined as a genetic disposition for male breast cancer. So for example, breast cancer, BRCA1, BRCA2, those two mutate in these two genes, in fact, contribute about 10 to 20% family breast cancer. However, up to now, all non-genetic disposition as represented by BRCA1, BRCA2, ATM, and so on, no more than 50%. There's still 50% of family breast cancer. What is the cause of them still remain unknown. Study is actively ongoing, but it's pretty slow. In the past 20 years or so, since BRCA1, BRCA2 were identified, people try to use all methods available on the market on the table, include linkage analysis, position cloning, genetic genomic array, targeted sequence, GWAS, exon sequence, you name it. And the sample size nowadays, when people try to hunt him for the unknown predisposition, easily go to tens of thousands. But the newly identified predisposition gene are very limited, very, very slow. If you can gain 1%, great progress. Think about that 50% still remain unknown. It will take how many years to finish this task? There's one issue here. Here, just take the example in the past couple of years, what people achieved in this field. There's a couple of genes identified, XRCC2, FAMCC, BLM, so on, so on. And those identified cases are through large population study, like easily go to 3,000, 4,000, 6,000. The total is 16,000 cases used in those studies. And there are a couple of cases, really mutation in this gene, happened in those cases, it's only 33 among 16,000 cases, so account for only 5.5%. So really, most of the new predisposition gene identified so far affect very small population sites. And even for the small population sites, the controversy happens. For example, in one study identified XRCC2, 5 out of 3,000 cases contain a mutation. And another group immediately replicated this study, another 3,000 or so. This is reverse. In the unaffected normal control, they have this mutation, but not the person in the breast cancer patient. So because of rarity of those mutations, so the result is really not convincing. So you explain all those situations, that this area has been well developed in this field based on past 20, 30 years study. the predisposition gene can be classified in three groups. One is high risk gene, one is intermediate risk gene, another one is modest risk genetic variants. So highest one is BRCA1, no question about that. And then intermediate risk gene is CHEK2. And the low one that with modest risk genetic variants, it's like all GWAS study identified many, many SNP. Each contribute very minor, but when combine all of them together, they may contribute those remaining unknown predispositions. That's what people know nowadays. That's the frequency, and this is the distribution. You see the highest one, BRCA1, BRCA2, and then second one is the P53, P10, and next one is CHEK2, PARPA2, ATM, and then remaining is other small affected genes. And then question is, for those 50-60% of the family breast cancer, do they really have a predisposition or they're not this kind of disease at all? Right, that's an open question. People nowadays still think there are some genetic disposition here. People still try very hard to figure them out. And then face this situation, I just wondering, can those be a family specific instead we go to a population manner? Everyone knows family breast cancer is autosomal dominant disease. It fits with a Mendelian genetic disease pattern. And each family, in fact, is enriched with a predisposition. And then folks on family may have much higher chance than folks on the position screening. Because in a single family, they already contain a mutation with 50% chance to get inherited from up generations. But when put all these cases together with another 10,000 patients, they have 50% chance identified here. Now you have 0.00% or 0.05% chance to identify those unknown genetic mutations. That's my hypothesis. To prove this one, we used a technique named exome sequencing to sequence all 20,000 genes in each individual, include affected and unaffected in many, many families. In fact, those were detected as BRCA1, BRCA2 mutation negative. There's no BRCA mutation. Then we try to use those as a model to test if our hypothesis is right. And exome sequencing, everyone knows about the exome sequence. It's next-gen sequence-based. And it targets 180,000 exome from 20,000 in a single individual genome. The contents sequence is about 1% of the genome, and the cost about one-fifth of the whole genome sequencing. And the most important issue is, so far, most of the genetic mutation cause genetic disease, 85% are known present in the exome. So it might have high chance to identify these unknown mutations. So this is the result from three families. After we sequence the genome, use a bioinformatical tool to identify all these mutations, and we immediately compare what is the overlapping between all these three big families. And the result was surprising. See, all this mutation identified, there's almost no overlapping between each family. And that's what tells that each family has its unique genetic pattern. Of course, that's genetic libraries. Then we look the what gene affected. This is in one of the family. You see all those gene family 1, 2, 3, and this is distribution of the mutation. Because each mutation theoretically has 50% chance to be transmitted in a single family. But those aren't overlapped, they're really transmitted in the family, you see. There's a distribution. Not everyone get affected. Some get affected higher, some get affected lower. Like this higher one, there may be family size, or when we pick the case with limits of DNA sample availability, they have a high chance to get those ones. But it's not 100% in all the cases. So that's one example. Cat6B. This gene, we frequently see in one of the family, this 3'N, they got mutated. And why pick up this family, this gene? It's because this gene is very well known, it's acetyltransferase. It's functional, very important. It's N-terminal, it's involved in transcription regulation, and its interaction with RUNX1, RUNX2, those are very important oncogene. It's a component of this complex involving DNA replication, transcription regulation, epigenetic modification, and mutation in this gene already known cause many diseases, genetic disease. But never known, this gene were related with family breast cancer. And then next question is, since this gene is so important and mutated in the family, and we do not see another two family, and then we scale up this screening for the mutation in this particular gene in 42 additional cancer from 26 families. No, we don't see any mutation. All families contain normal copy of this gene. And that's the picture. All right, 2 minutes. This is real distribution of the entire coding mutation in each individual represent 26 families. That's very, very little overlapping. So the picture, we believe it should be like this. Those are already known genetic mutation, and then with high frequency go to low, and when it goes extremely low here, in fact, the further became this, like this pattern, each spot represents a mutation in each single family. And those are known mutation, decreased frequency, finally go to family-based genetic predisposition. So I think that's a fit with what we believe nowadays. It should be precision medicine, personalized medicine, family medicine, you name it. This is the collaborator for this project that's in my lab, in my campus. And then we thanks very much Dr. Henry Rinch, famous oncogenist, founder of the family breast cancer study. We used many samples from his DNA bank. Okay, I'll stop here. Thanks.
Thank you very much for this very interesting talk. Here, I must give you this presentation here.